when I actually started, which was very, 18 years back. You must be wondering, whom did I get in touch? So one of them was Menon. By then he was actually in the industry, and by then he was also in the recruitment, business. And so I would always call him as the Pitamaha of recruiting industry. But the most important, when I say Pitamaha, is somebody who's changing with the time. I think he's a very critical. He's just latest and updated. I think that's the most critical. And I don't think any millennials can, compete with him in terms of the speed at which that he catch up on technology and all that. I think that keeps him apart from anybody. And that's why I thought, okay, after a very long time, I get an opportunity to, meet him. So over to Menon. Menon, I would like you to just give a bit of brief background about yourself, so that it just summarizes your expertise and experience.
Hey Gia, thanks. You just told about 18 years back. Otherwise, my entire age would have been known. So, I mean, to be honest, I've been hiring much longer than that. It's about 28 years now. And you're talking about millennials, okay? I think most of them relate to social media. I started recruiting before LinkedIn, before Facebook, before Google. Okay, before mobile phone or internet was also there. Okay. So I mean, it's purely survival mode. So constantly, whenever the world has changed, I've tried to reinvent myself, and I'm glad even after 28 years we can be relevant. Nothing like it. All yours. Over
Okay.
the time, I've transformed into a global recruiter now. Essentially, I help companies find talent they can't find themselves. Over to you.
And also, I think one of the very critical things that I found was that returning Indians as one of the very key aspects that Menon has always mastered. And whoever was wanting to come back, I think looks like, when I say this, a lot of our NRI friends who are sitting elsewhere and whose H1s are getting over and all that, probably they must be looking at you now. But today's focus, I'm actually wanting to really focus on, because the changes that are happening in the business, and also there is an axe which is going to fall on many in any case. But however, one focus that I wanted to, on this particular show, I want to do is on the senior management, especially because they are the ones who are too busy in their jobs, and we find it very difficult in managing, their career transition whenever we do assignments together, me and Menon. So hence, I thought maybe this is very, very important that we should really talk about the senior management, their threat today, and also how they can really prepare, even if they were not prepared earlier, in case if there is any axe fall, or in case the circumstances forces them to look out into a transition into the new roles. So first thing I would like to ask Menon, in terms of a question which is more pertinent, that how's the economy looking like in terms of a recruiting? Just give me an overall view of what it is looks like today, transitioning to tomorrow as an environment.
See, as environment, I don't think anybody is talking about hiring right now. Okay? I've been part of a global recruitment network, and I think from March 15th, okay, across the world, okay, most companies have gone into the whole lockdown mode, and the primary focus has been for every company to look after the safety and health of their own employees. So yes, the companies which have made offers earlier have gone ahead and continue to onboard people, but I don't think there has been any new mandates for hiring as yet. Probably it's too early to do it. I think even right now, most are worried about once the lockdown is closed, how do they start operations? And there is a kind of a feeling that it will take a little while before it comes to normalcy, because most companies, thanks to the social distancing norms, people are thinking in terms of having 50% people coming in, shift working, and a whole lot of other things. So it's business as usual as far as regular work is concerned. Hiring for new mandate is not a priority right now.
So I know that there's a huge impact that we see. In fact, just a survey that we are going to conclude, and you know, I'm going to give out the results very quickly. Pulse survey, you know, in this week that we're going to release. One of it says that from the March itself, there was a deduction on salary of a senior management, not on the staff level. Okay. And April and May, we found that actually almost 50% less number of companies who decided to reduce the salaries for senior management. I think that forces us to the real topic why I really wanted to really focus on this today, is that the senior management to CXO level positions and their impact. Menon, I would like to ask with the industry, what are the changes that you are finding in the senior management and the CXO level positions in various industries? I mean, are there anybody who's hiring at this point of a time, if at all?
Yeah, so the point is, I've been in touch with most of the senior management, both CXO level as well as hiring heads. And like I told you, at the moment, they are concerned about probably looking at how it's going to impact their payroll. And yes, some companies have decided to take, defer promotions or defer annual increments, defer the bonus part of it. Some other companies have decided to cut the salary of senior management up to 40%. But the fact remains that this particular COVID, has forced most of organizations to use technology, and in the process of working at home, I'm afraid it has exposed a lot of middle and senior management people who are not digitally competent. So there used to be a over tendency on micromanaging. People used to have several meetings which kind of they collated the information and gave it. And now there are a lot of people who are found napping there. Okay? So I'm pretty sure when the industry opens up and companies think of managing the burden of their financial balance sheets and all that, the first set of people who will be on vulnerable will be the senior management people. And I mean, there are several examples, because I just posted about that on LinkedIn the other day, yes, a couple of days. There's a startup that I knew, and they don't see a visibility of any revenue for next 6 months. So quickly they did an audit and figured out the top six people probably account for the salaries of the remaining 36 people. Okay.
Right.
And and so the choice was to remove senior management people, because that would help the company sustain for the next few months, because you have to stay alive to be around there when the COVID is over. So one of the key things is even before, and frankly, before COVID also, especially in industries like infrastructure and IT, I have seen this particular symptom of middle management vanishing in the last 2 years. Okay, there has been an unwritten rule of 40 or 45. Okay, it means either the 45 age or 45 lakhs of salary. Most companies had actually consciously stopped replacing people of that level. So if the people had left and gone, they wouldn't refill that position at the same salary. And there were things where instead of hiring somebody at 45 lakhs, they probably started hiring three people at 15 lakh salary and felt that the output would be more practical. So this is something which I have seen over the last few years, both infrastructure as in your real estate, builder community and all that. And unfortunately, they have been running on this 40% drop in salaries for almost 2-3 years now. And that has itself become a retention policy for the company. Okay, because people don't leave the jobs because there's so much skin in the game.
Yeah.
So it's very, very sad, but I guess there's a quote by Warren Buffett. Okay. It's when the tide is down, when you know who has been swimming naked. Okay. So I think it's a time now to review all costs on the balance sheet. And yeah, I'm afraid it is the middle and senior management people who are probably paid higher, who will be on the first focus. And so my own gut feeling is going forth, tenure or seniority is not going to be an issue. It's going to be the kind of skills you bring to the table and whether you're able to work in projects without the micromanaging part. So if these three skills are there, and of course, if you are digitally competent, I think your career is a little lot more safer than a lot of other people.
We also seen this in Reliance yesterday. I think, see, if anybody makes a news or not, that may not be so visible. But, you know, now that Reliance has communicated yesterday formally that, you know, above 15 lakhs, you know, there is going to be an axe. And the chairman himself is going to take 100%, you know, cut. So there is a strong indication that's going to happen to strengthen what you're actually saying. And I'm really sure that there is going to be definitely a challenge. But I also kind of wants to warn everybody that, yes, there is a sense of, you know, feeling for people that I think jobs are going to go and, you know, all that. I think this may be a, you know, time that people can give a bad news pretty easier and faster. And people do accept, you know, unlike the other situations earlier.
Yeah, right? I agree with you. I absolutely agree with you. Because, in fact, we've been reading about it in the last 5 years. Okay. That 5 years back, they said that robots are going to take over the jobs of humans. Okay. Then after that, you had this thing which says that AI and ML is going to take over the jobs of people. And then while we all were aware that, okay, most human jobs will not go, but it is very apparent that humans who can use technology will be more valuable. I think this particular thing has been coming in the last 5 years. It is just that the COVID has made us sensitive that this is a milestone. Otherwise, the trend was always there. It's just that we were in a state of denial. Okay, and none of these technologies, Zoom or all this, they all existed even before COVID. People could have worked from home or remotely even earlier. But I guess these unprecedented times are primarily because it was thrust on us. And for some time we've been in the denial. And I personally feel that going forth, I mean, like you said, this will be an excuse for cleaning up of the system.
Yeah. So I know that there is quite a bit of talk happening on now that we learned to be able to work remotely, right? With the demonetization, India probably would have got the digital advantage of actually, you know, making digital payments, etc. But with I think COVID, the work from home seems to have really caught up, and then people, at least the industries, those who can afford, right? I think that is where it is. And with this, we also see that there is a whole lot of gig economy which is going to open up in terms of the new jobs are going to be much in shorter duration, etc., like through a gig workers, maybe a specialized. So what do you think is the impact of such economy on the senior management and, you know, such positions, Menon? I mean, what is your take on that?
Yeah, let me differentiate. Gig economy that we hear of is mostly in terms of the employment period being shorter.
Okay? Yeah.
And also you should understand most of the economy you talk about is thanks to Uber and Swiggy and those kind of people, where people by choice have been doing additional assignments on their own. Okay? And they probably are getting paid. But believe me, this COVID is going to open up a lot more in terms of freelance kind of thing. And that I would like to say is different from gig, because if you look at historically, okay, my father joined an organization, retired. You and I probably worked in industry for 10 years before starting our own organization. But in those 10 years, we probably changed jobs only once in 5 or 6 years. But now, if you notice everybody around, it's an intellectual economy. People change jobs once in 2-3 years. So there's really no sanctity of a permanent job, okay? And so what is happening is with technology, globalization and all happening, I think this tenure is definitely going to go down. And just as we as consumers have adopted so many new best practices, Swiggy or Airbnb or Uber and stuff like that, where we only pay for the service. We don't own the particular equipment or whatever. I have a feeling very soon in industry also, they will start no? hiring people on demand. Okay, there will be a hybrid way of operation. The company will decide whether how many permanent employees should they have, how many work from home employees do they have, how many part-time employees should they have, do they need to hire people on projects, you know? So this is going to be the distinct change. And I can also tell you, over the last couple of months, there have been a lot of reports. There's an organization which is called flexit.com, okay, run by one Chandrika Pasricha. Okay, she's a very bright lady who was an earlier McKinsey employee. And she has a website which deals in freelancers. There are over 70,000 freelancers there across Asia. And you'll be surprised that during this lockdown also, they have been getting a lot of assignments. People are not willing to hire a new person, but are willing to hire experts who can be available for the 20 hours to 60 hours or for 2 to 3 weeks. Okay. So the, as I probably those who listen to me on my blogs and all will understand, it's a very unique crossroad we have now. Work is changing, workplace is changing, and workforce is changing. Yeah. And therefore we will see new business models. And when there are new business models, it will have impact on our careers. And we somehow have had this thing that it's a long-term thing. I think we'll, individuals have to take charge of their own careers. They have to invest in training themselves. We have to constantly learn, unlearn, relearn, kind of a thing. So that's my personal.
I think we will share that link of Chandrika that you mentioned. After this thing, probably we'll post it on the Facebook. And for teams, you know, who's watching, probably you can also ask questions. There are some questions which are already there, but I have a few set of questions which I wanted to make sure that it is completed, you know, in a sequence. But for anybody who comes on to this live thing later, I would like them to get that information which is predefined, you know, so that the retention span is quite less. So hence, you know, I'm actually rushing into the questions that I have. I will take some of the questions that Vivek has asked already. And also there are questions which have come from Amit and all that. So I will definitely ask those questions. So one of the things that I would like to ask is that what is the best way that a senior management kind of a professionals should be doing or maybe lacking at this point of time? Let's focus on what is that they are lacking today. Maybe what they should do, we will focus later. But what do you think from a career transition perspective, what do you think are the missing links of the senior management, you know, at this point of time, Manan?
Okay. So let me actually quote a Harvard HBR article 2 years back, okay, which today we feel resonates much more. Okay, they had mentioned at that point of time that the future of work will depend on somebody who is digitally competent. Okay, it's digital is not a separate department in an organization. Every job, be it HR or marketing or finance, all of them will need to now use digital. Okay, if you look at our own things, in the last 5 weeks, we have been forced to so many webinars and company meetings. And we can see the people who are more adept at handling Zoom and handling those meetings are more influential and effective. So these are skills which are not impossible to pick, but a lot of people have been reluctant to adopt to digital. Okay, and this is a very interesting article which they say about 4 skills which a senior management or a leadership person should have. And they call it HAVE, H-A-V-E. Okay, H is supposed to be humility in learning. Okay, what happens is we often think that since we are older and experienced, we have this hang up about learning new things. Okay, and better companies and senior professionals have decided to do reverse mentoring and learn all the new tools kind of a thing. So humility in learning is one skill which is definitely required. A is adapting. And we need to adapt to the change of way of business is what's happening is, especially with today's world, that the linear organization is definitely going to go off, okay, because we have a matrix organization right now. I have a boss probably who's sitting in Singapore whom I have not seen. The Singapore boss is probably working with somebody in America who's not seeing. So now what will happen is, we'll have to influence without authority. Okay. And that is a job not only for managers within the company, but also managers with external facing roles. Earlier, you could get away with your seniority or a title and kind of a thing. But now adapting to this changing requirement is there. Third is V, which is actually vision. There is a lot of confusion. There is a lot of complexity. And nobody has enough information about how the world is going to change. But you never can wait for enough information to take a decision. You need to work through that ambiguity and have a gut feeling. Okay? And the fourth one is engagement. It's no longer about one-way traffic that I say, you listen. Okay, and the first time after so many years that, I mean, we have 2-3 generations of people working in the organization, people of my age, who 55 plus, they're still there.
It's a very tough challenge for correct. People, that's something that we can't give up.
Correct. And then the new millennial are coming at 2022, and they're used to calling each other in the first name basis, without sir and stuff like that, and they are ready to question a whole lot of things they were done. So it is increasingly becoming for any organization to engage and be relevant. So I think those skills, irrespective of whether you're a HR guy or a finance guy or a marketing guy, is have those humility in learning, adaptability, the vision to understand what's beyond what is obvious, and engagement, apart from the digital skills. So I feel that any of us, I mean, the very fact that you and I are we never used to this way of talking, okay? But over the last couple of months, we picked up those skills. We may be stumbling, but I'm sure sooner or later, we will gain expertise on this.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I think some of the points that you mentioned are an indication for those who are actually in the transition or maybe may get a transition in the future, should be looking at those and inculcate those qualities, I would say, right now on the job, okay? So that you are more relevant when you go out into the market to really explore opportunities. So what is that one thing, if you have to say, that they should be doing to be able to get to a new transition much faster and easier manner?
See, personally, I'm very convinced it's networking. Okay. No longer, apart from the parents who take care of you, okay, there's nobody else who's going to take care of you. Okay, today, if you are a professional, you need to take care of your own career. And I would advise anybody, be it a junior level, middle or senior, they think of themselves as a CEO of their own brand. Okay, so they have to look at personal branding. They have to manage their personal career. And one way to do it is networking. Because wherever you work, there's a set of relationships you build, there's a set of knowledge that you pick up, irrespective of the company that you're working with. And that's something which you need to leverage on to so that it's always lonely when you're on your own. And I think networking is the only solution for us to stay connected with the rest of the world and have a kind of a mentor who is able to give you some kind of an advice, which we often don't have. We are in denial mode. We have blind spots. I think this is the only thing which differentiates between the best and the rest. Because I've been in recruitment. I mean, I first was in the job market in 1984 when I finished my MBA. Okay. And it's now 36 years in the industry. And I see that the best jobs really don't go to the best person, but the right person at the right place. And this right person and right place is a function of networking. Earlier, we never acknowledged it. Today, it is a reality. So
today it's even more easier, than earlier. So earlier, if I remember, I had met you personally, right? Physically, I came to your office, not even called, right? But today, I think, let's see, on the Facebook, now the comments are, you know, happening. That means they are interacting, and I think that there's a huge, definitely a totally a different, you know, opportunity, you know, altogether. And I also like one thing that Menon mentioned in one of my questions to him yesterday was to get discovered is going to be the key. Okay, so Menon, I would like you to really talk about this discoverability, because this is something that I feel is going to be the game changer for those who are into transitions now.
Like I told you earlier, see, we forget as consumers, we adapt to all new habits and new behavioral pattern. Now, because it's become a habit now, no matter what question I have, I go to Google. Okay, if I have a stomachache, or if I want to find a, buy a car, or if I want to find a house in something, it's become a habit to Google. And when you search, Google has all the answers. Okay. So, and then, but then the irony is that it has thousands and thousands of pages of answers. And so if, as individuals, so you notice that we don't go beyond the first or second page. So I personally feel today the economy, so when you do it as a consumer, I think as a professional also, there's no reason why you can't leverage on that fact. So if you are not on the first page, or if you are not Googleable, okay, I don't think you exist. Because people have choice. And you notice, I mean, it said that everybody has, attention span is becoming lesser and lesser. So nobody has that kind of time to, you know. So you see, if you're Googleable, you find. And so therefore, my advice to people is, if you were looking for a job, the best way to find a job is to make yourself found by somebody looking to solve his or her pain point. And so therefore, you have to be online. You need to be today. I mean, whether you like it or not, there are so many social media sites, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Insta. And my first reaction today, if I want to know about anybody, is immediately go on online and find out their social media online footprint. Yeah. And then before I've called the person, I've made up my mind. Okay. Oh, this is the person who does this. He goes to holidays. He has a lavish style, he's partying. Then I see.
I don't know if you remember, Menon, sometime back, there was something called a Yetido, which is a person search engine, actually. I think eventually it has become a recruiting engine right now. But I think, you know, that's one of the thing instead of Googling you used to do. But now, right now, what you said is right. You know, when you are Googled, how do you get, identified? So I think a digital strategy, not just only for a company, but I think it's also important for people as they're growing up in their careers, because, you know, one of the important thing is that you have very less number of positions as you go up in the hierarchy. Right?
And one more point just struck me when you talk about Google, because Google is now the god of information. For anything you want, you'll find Google. There's nothing that Google doesn't know, which you know, okay?
Yeah.
But that's one more ability which I wanted to tell you. I told you about digital thing. I think today, since Google has all the answers, one of the questions, we need to know how to ask the right questions. Okay, I think that is one skill which we have not learned. Because when we grew up in school and saying, we always respected the senior people, and whatever they said was gospel truth. Okay, but today's generation actually asks you why it should be done and why it cannot be done that way. So that's another skill which middle management and senior management should pick up, because not go with the herd mentality, but understand the why.
Yeah. And I think especially with the age catching up, and, you know, you're very busy with your so many commitments, you know, that's what I think also makes. And also very unfortunate that I would always refer this as the EMI lives that they are living. So naturally these things are forgotten. So probably we would like to appeal on this forum, you know, to be able to be little conscious and, you know, spend little time for yourself, not just immerse into whatever you are doing, but I think just make sure that your presence, not just for looking for a job, but staying relevant and also being able to get discovered. So one of the things which is very important is, as you're growing up, probably you may want to get into, you know, a lot of speaking engagements, etc. That also can happen through through search, that you should be able to really get discovered. So not necessarily only for a transition, but also to grow up into your next career. So there are some questions which are coming up, Menon, I would like to take so that, our friends, you know, stay afloat. So there's one question from, of course, Vivekananda, Vivek, Chittampally, you know, friend.
Yeah, yeah, a good friend of mine too.
On live, he has a question that, you know, what would be the impact of office spaces and, you know, with the remote working is practically made possible because of this, impact. So I would definitely would like you to say, how is it also going to impact on the job market side as well?
See, personally, I feel it will impact differently for different sizes of organizations. Okay. I think one is the SME crowd, which, you know, definitely is conscious about cost of maintaining the business. Forget about them. Actually, one of my clients in Chennai, which is a 40 members IT company, they were actually, this was an eye-opener for them because they realized that they've been spending almost 5-6 lakhs per month salary, rent over the last so many years, air conditioned and stuff like that. Now they realize that most of these IT professionals can continue working at home. There's no really need for them to commute and come to a particular physical space. So this particular thing is a company with only a 40 member team. They feel that 4 or 5 member people can actually work in a co-working space and they can continue to have these meetings and stuff like that if they need. So they are not going to definitely have retail space, henceforth is what they've indicated. But at the same time, there's another company which is a semiconductor company, which is a multinational company, and they have looked at it totally differently. Now, what they have come up with, all these companies which have big reserves suddenly realize that because of the travel restrictions and social distancing kind of a thing, they have saved more than $4 million in travel over the next 1 year. So they have a kitty of 4 million, which they are now willing to invest in either hiring people or training them or even having additional space for offices if need be. Because with this distance of 6 feet difference kind of a thing, if an office earlier could have house about 100 people, now to house the same 100 people, you probably have to have double the size. So I think different companies will react to it differently, but the impact is going to be for people who have the choice of deciding where to work, because it's now going to become anywhere, anytime work. And those who are good can pick and choose, you know, whether they'd like to work from home or work remotely. I don't think it will have too much of impact in Hyderabad as of now. IT companies will continue to.
Okay, so I have another question coming from Amit Bhargava. What type of categories of jobs will be outsourced is a question.
Yeah, I mean, frankly, I think you look at an Indian industry in the last 30 years, 25 years. Prior to 1994, we never had IT industry. We never had IT ES industry, okay? And most of our growth today has come primarily because of that, okay? India became a back office for a whole lot of US multinationals and other things. And believe me, the writing was on the wall there itself, okay? We should have realized that if the work could go from US to India, it can also go from India to Manila or some other place that's cheaper, okay? Right. And now what's happening post-COVID, we realize that these jobs can also go to work from home kind of a situation. Exactly. Okay. So I feel anything which is routine and automatic and monotonous will be outsourced. Okay. And if it is not strategic, it will be offshored. And if it can be done on projects, it will be freelanced. So if you've got to be part of the core team, you have to pull your, you have got to pull your strength there. I mean, it's simple as that. Okay, yeah. So I think a lot of jobs will go, because even you and I, we know, unless we are an organization of particular size, we don't need a full-time HR person or a full-time finance manager. So these are all there because we have seen chartered accountants working in multiple companies. and lawyers also work in multiple companies. Doctors also, not everybody has a nursing home and a big hospital. So while we are seeing these things happen in the other areas of life, we somehow thought that it will not affect us.
So if you see, I think 18 years back, what Hughes started is also, you know, some kind of on the similar lines, you know, each of our associates actually are distributed to actually
the company.
So I think it's everywhere, it's there. And I'm sure catching up is the only way, you know, to look at. So there's one question from Chaitanya Vatti, who is CV Corp.
Okay. Okay.
Uh-huh. I'm sure he is doing a lot of good work, you know, with the preparing people for the future. And especially the younger generation. So I'm sure. So his question was that I have one question to discuss. So he's of course that, you know, there is a job cuts and everything is happening. I think that is what he's referring to. Maybe we will take it offline because now this is more in relation to the job specific thing that we are focusing. Then I have one more question. I don't know, somebody called All Time. Sorry, I really don't know the name, but that's what is featuring on the Facebook. So All Time, I respect you for asking the question. Here is my first question. In case of mid-level professionals, what are the advices from to get hired onboarded? Does it mean that for mid-level professionals, how do they get hired? Probably, I think that's the question.
Okay, let me try and, you and I, GR, we worked on that outplacement assignment for AstraZeneca. Okay, for any professional, there are four choices at any point of time. Okay? Either they look for a similar job in another company, the same industry, number one. Number two, look at a similar job in a new industry. Three, pick up new skills and pivot into a totally new industry with transplanting your skills. And fourth is doing something on your own. Okay. Because depending on your age and the skills, you might have, and if the permanent jobs are not going to be there on a regular basis, you might as well build your own career. Okay. On your own career.
So the question is asked by Mohana. She just clarified her name. Yeah, go ahead.
So these are the options. Basically, either you have to take charge of your own inventory of skills, see which are relevant in today's market. And like the same question somebody else asked, can it be offshored? Can be outsourced? Now, do we have a skill which can be done cheaper by somebody else? Then why would an employer choose us? Okay, so we need to be constantly looking at the inventory of skills we possess and see how relevant we are with the changing times. So the options are just that, you know, either change a job or change the industry or probably, you know, pick up new skills. And today there is enough of free online courses which are happening. The future of jobs is going to be a lot of skills which didn't exist. Because I remember when I started back in 92 recruitment, the kind of assignments which I got was the first, any company needed a stenographer or a receptionist. Okay. Now today that jobs don't exist. Okay. Because most managers are...
Of them have become HR managers, Manan.
Correct. So that's because that's the hallmark of their ability to adapt. Because they understood that they needed new skills. And they also started managing people better. And that is why they are there. Okay. But if they had remained typist or if they had remained stenographer, they would have lost their job. Today, if you go to any IT company, it's a security guy who handles the reception. Okay.
Exactly.
And those stenographers have gone. Everybody's checking mail on their own. Okay. So soon, lots of jobs like this. I mean, even in IT industry, I know a company which laid off 40 people in the QA and testing department because over the few years, QA and testing was earlier manual testing, which became automated testing. And now the companies are wondering, why do we invest in such a high paid employee who is anyway going to use automated testing tools? And so they have decided to shift that particular thing to developers. They are preferring to pay the developer a 20% high salary and removed a QA and testing. It depends on the role you are in. It's it's the value that you bring in on a monthly basis, which is going to make yourself figure how valuable you are to your employer.
Yeah.
I do hope I have answered it.
So I know that one of my observations is that the growth of small mid-sized enterprises in the country are definitely dependent on the frontline managers, and because of the micromanagement and all that, and now that you know there is a completely a shift happening, if the companies have to survive, they have to go digitally and look at, you know, how effectively that they can, you know, work remotely and all. So I see that there is going to be a bigger challenge for those people who have been, you know, focusing only on, you know, micromanagement, etc. And these are the challenges which are going to come in definitely. One question that I have, Menon, is that I know that there is a lot of investment happening on the hiring side, because that is one thing that has not been cracked by the world so far in terms of hiring the right person. And then lots of investment, billions of dollars are put into create technologies. You know, I know at least a dozen of companies who raised 200 million kind of a level worldwide, you know, to solve the problem of recruiting. So I would like to really ask that, how are these going to have an impact in today's world on the, you know, hiring, especially again, you know, we'll focus on mid to, you know, senior level kind of hiring. How are these going to make, be a game changer, you know, for such hiring practices within the organizations, Menon?
Sure. See, if you were to, what's happening with the advent of technology is, every company is trying to be more efficient in terms of both the time as well as the quality of impact. Okay, so as far as recruitment is concerned, initially it was seen as one particular domain where you had, you know, a series of activities to be done. I have seen the modern companies, they have broken up recruitment into three or four different steps. One is scoping, which is basically deciding the job description. Then is sourcing, then screening, and selection, okay, and onboarding. So we now have, so what's happening is now companies are able to break it up and then decide as to which of those things can be done internally, which can be automated, and which can be outsourced, kind of a thing. So technology is helping. I mean, today, if you look at sourcing and assessments, a lot of technological tools have gone into that. Okay. But fortunately, screening is still the domain of human beings, because we still need to understand, we are dealing with humans, okay? So we need to understand the motivation, the willingness to work, the ability to work, and stuff like that. So fortunately, screening is still, brings in the human aspect. So that's not something which we will see, you know, which will be automated. But it's something like how your doctors, today if you go to any doctor, he tells you to do so many tests. Okay, we'll give you a dozen tests, and then he or she just spends the time based on the diagnosis, based on the reports, then gives the diagnosis. Nobody's going to ever take away that ability to diagnose. Okay, right. Testing part will go off. So I think it's the same thing. HR, because it's human relations, and the today with just like you mentioned about companies, now machine and money is ubiquitous. Anybody can get it. The quality of the company is going to differ on the quality of the human capital they engage. That's going to make the difference between the best and the rest. So I don't see technology replacing the human. But yes, if a person is not technologically competent or doesn't know how to use technology for decision making, he isn't likely to be extinct.
Yeah, so I'm sure, you know, there are companies, n number of companies which are actually building these tools to make their life easier. So probably I think recruiters don't have to really sift through, you know, thousands of applications, etc. And then probably one question I have, do you think that there is a validity for a resume in these days, and does it exist? Does it need to exist?
Well, definitely increase, because see, the all said and done, even though we talked about a resume is just about skills, okay, what you should understand is there is a human being behind the skills, and there is a need for us to tell the story, okay, how we are different from so many other people. And there is no other. So if you look at, I mean, there's been a lot of talk about LinkedIn profiles will probably be the future. Okay, but the point is, if you see 10 LinkedIn profiles which have the same kind of formats, it's very difficult to understand the person behind the resume. So I would feel resume is important primarily for getting that meeting. Okay, and I would still feel that there's a need for a covering note which will allow the reader understand the journey that the person has taken. And now it will be more and more obvious. Layoffs will happen. There will be gaps in the resume. Earlier, a resume was used to reject people.
Yeah.
Okay. We used to reject. We wanted to kind of only a premier institute person we wanted. Or if we thought he's a good marks, you could. If he didn't get good marks, you rejected. Or if he has gaps in the resume, you rejected. But now, I feel the margin of error is going to be very high. It's not only important that you hire the right person, but also it's very costly if you do not hire the right person. Okay, I don't know whether this is a story which I love to tell, so that you've heard of this guy called Brian Acton. Okay, this gentleman was rejected by Facebook and Google. And then he went on to make his own company, which is called WhatsApp. Okay, and Facebook, to get him back, had to pay through the nose, okay, almost $18-19 billion. So the cost of not hiring a good person is much higher than cost of hiring a wrong person. So right. I have a feeling right now the industry is worried about cost to hire, time to fill. These are metrics will be soon dumped. We'll start looking at quality of hire. And when we look at quality of hire, I think the person behind the resume will become more important.
Right. So I think there are some more questions which have come in. Mona also asked one question also. And also there's a relevant question by another person, Rajesh, who's not able to join. I would request each one of you who are watching, if you have questions, you know, please do drop in. I'm going to take each one by one just to make sure that we make your time valuable for being here on this and, you know, watching us here. So what is the future of the recruiting industry, you know, as such? What is a, you know, what is a, how's the recruiters are going to survive as a business in the future?
I mean, I thought I answered that earlier. The cost of hiring a wrong person is significantly lower than the cost of not hiring the right person. Okay. So, I mean, and yeah, I mean, all said and done, there has been a lot of changes in the way recruitment business also evolved. Or if you were to look at 20 years back, companies decided to use third-party consultants primarily because the internal HR teams was stretched, okay, doing a whole lot of stuff. Then the first thing which they did was try and bring in recruitment teams internally, so that they, I mean, primarily because of cost of hiring and stuff like that, they decided to have go to outsiders only when they didn't find talent themselves. And personally, I feel that it had got to do a lot with the cost of hiring and the CTCs and all that. And so you've actually noticed in the last 5-6 years, a lot of excellent senior recruiters have now moved into corporates because they have become talent acquisition kind of people. And so there is a distinct change in the way companies have been looking at using sourcing, employer branding, thinking of candidate experience, and they personally feel that third-party recruiters are a lot more sensitive to the needs of the people. Okay, that's the diligent feeling. So there is a feeling that a person who is employed and have a salary may not be as efficient as somebody whose life is depending on success and stuff like that. So recruitment industry is changing. I have a feeling that definitely the business models will change. But as long as, like I told you earlier, the human capital is going to be a differentiator between the best companies and the rest, it will continue to be important. In fact, earlier recruitment was probably part of the HR department. The junior most person was put in the recruitment department. But as you see the better companies now, you have talent acquisition as a separate vertical. And now that employer branding and things are becoming important, there's also a talk of whether recruitment and talent acquisition should be part of marketing. Okay. And there are very good examples of Pepsi and Virgin Atlantic where they have seen that a bad candidate experience can also lead to loss of market share. Okay. So I think recruitment is going to be critical, but the old habits definitely will not be relevant. We have to move away from just pushing resumes or, you know, spraying and posting and stuff like that to probably making data decision, data-driven decision making. I think that to be the role which recruiter will have to play.
I also see that, you know, you mentioned that they are no longer the recruiting business; they are a talent advisory business.
Exactly.
That's going to be the very key. Just to summarize, you know, whatever you are actually said, you already quoted this. I used it on to post it on my LinkedIn, you know, just to inform people that this is very important. Now, the most important thing, while we are talking about a senior management, Menon, I think this is very important aspect which we wanted to really talk about it. And also Sandeep B. Budrani, he actually also mentioned that, would love to know if the person can join the board of directors in any public company. Is one segment that we will come to, but however, I think one of the other option, you know, especially for the senior management level, one I've been very always advisory about is that when they look at, there are two ways to look at. One, they start up on their own, or they become an advisors. Okay, advisors in various capacities, and definitely most of the startups today are done by the young talent. And they need lots of wisdom. They need a lot of exposure. They need lots of times to validate their ideas. I am sure that there are going to be humongous opportunities that are going to exist for these senior professionals from the industry, right? I feel that there is definitely a chance of 30 to 35% of these startups are going to anyway vanish, you know, in this COVID situation. But the remains are going to be very stronger. So that means there is a definitely a clear opportunity for the senior management to really be able to attach with them. But one thing I'm sure, not to look at as a salary, you know, that's one area. And one area which Sandeep was really mentioning is that definitely as a board of directors or maybe as a partner, working partner, and, you know, there are a lot of other opportunities that can be. And being on a public company board of directors is a very different ball game altogether. I'm sure they need a lot of education on that. There are institutions which actually helps the independent board of directors. I think that one should be also be trained. I wanted to just communicate through this forum that they should use that as one of the very critical thing. In fact, actually, people are not going to join on the board of directors of companies because the norms have become such stringent that tomorrow anything happens to the public company, you know, you're on the axe. In fact, people are actually withdrawing somebody who was already there, right? And definitely there are opportunities to be on the board of companies that are, you know, startups where, you know, you can also be an expert, you know, as such. Any other questions, people do, you know, post it there. I'm sure it's 12:53. We have just.
Oh, I didn't realize this.
We didn't realize. So 8 minutes. I will, you know, wind it off. One other thing, I always say some inputs, Menon. You know, you must give because I use most of the times Menon's expertise in coaching the senior teams, senior managers whom we are doing outplacement for large multinationals. I use very exclusively ask for an hour or a 2 hours from Menon to help them on LinkedIn as one of the most important things. Menon, I would like you to really, you know, in brief, if you can say how they can use the power of LinkedIn, especially at a senior management level, you know, in the transition period, Menon.
Yeah, so probably we'll go back to that point where you said that one has to be discoverable. Okay? And I also alluded to the fact that we have to be responsible for our own careers. So I feel today what differentiates between two people is the personal branding. Okay. And LinkedIn, by virtue of its professional networking, being a professional networking site, which has 670 million people across the world, is probably the most Googleable.
The fact that we have,
I think there's some echo coming in.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so LinkedIn primarily is the single largest professional networking site, and therefore, if you are having a good profile and you use it to engage and build relationships with other professionals, like I earlier alluded to, networking as a very important skill that we need to do. There is no shortcut. Okay, personal branding is critical, so as to networking, and there is a need for us all professionals to brand ourselves, or at least appear to be the thought leaders or, you know, subject matter experts, and so that you are a sought out person in your area of specialization. Okay, we do it in all our, as a consumer, like I said, even if you choose a doctor, we do our research to find out which is a specialist doctor in which area and stuff like that. So LinkedIn is probably the single most tool which helps an employer in the branding of the person. And apart from that, it's a fantastic learning tool. There's so much of content which is there, as well as opportunity to network. I really don't think, you know, it's a real no-brainer kind of a thing. So while people do spend time on Facebook and other places which are more for leisure and entertainment, I would feel there is a need for us to invest in our own professional branding, and LinkedIn would be a great tool. I've also seen off late even SMEs who are now trying to use LinkedIn to get customers they were not used to. Okay, earlier you could probably depend on a pipeline which is very local, but now the world is your market. And you know, you can attract customers all across the world. So LinkedIn is a great opportunity to you for you to go online and be global.
Yeah, also I think I would like to add there, Menon, is also that people with lots of experience should start sharing, should start commenting, should start, you know, giving their inputs. So there are many ways, you know, like you have LinkedIn Pulse, and even in Facebook there is Notes, you know, which is available. I think start really writing. You know, writing is a very challenging job. I'm sure you may know so much, but, you know, I think that is one of the things which is very important for especially the senior managers who may want to really, you know, focus on that. This one question that Amit Bhargav has asked earlier was in terms of what type of cultural transformation journey will organization need to take to adapt or adopt to the new normal? You know, that's his question. Would you like to react on that?
I really wouldn't. I'm sure there's a lot of other people who will be more adept at answering that. I am pure recruiter. Okay, I can tell you what's the demand and supply part of it. Okay, but coming back to your LinkedIn issue, networking, a primary value of networking is, you know, is giver's gain. If you help somebody else become successful, that person in turn will help you becoming successful. Also, I'm part of BNI, so I'm very happy to see that it's coming in. So they say that what goes around, what comes around. So you have to be giving, and only then can you expect to take. So engagement, sharing is
very challenging thing, Menon. You know, sorry to disturb there, because people do approach, you know, a friend. They remember a friend only when they're in need. I mean, it's something which I think pinches many a times. You know, then, you know, sometimes actually I don't even hesitate to say sometimes that when a call comes, say, "Arey, kaise hai? You know, how are you?" and all that. I said, "Now tell me, you know, are you looking for a change?" So I think that is one thing. Probably I would like it to be now, you know, vocally I'm actually sharing on an open platform, because it's very important. You must be on a regular basis be in touch with people. It's not just necessary that, you know, you just you know, come on and
It should not be opportunistic alone. Okay, you need to be giving and nurturing relationships. It's all about relationship building.
And also there's one question. My query is, which of the below will be the future in hiring aspects, permanent hiring or contact hiring? So I think we referred to this a bit earlier stage, right?
I don't think there's any sanctity for permanent hiring today. Okay. Yes. And it will be contract hiring or part-time hiring, or there are even I can think of certain companies which have had two people. One person comes in 3 days a week, and the other person comes the remaining day. There'll be new models very soon.
Yeah. So one thing, Amit, now that he asked that question, I would like to really say on the type of cultural transformation journey that the organization will go through is because actually, if you see, the external environment itself is forcing us to change. And we will bring in all these behaviors into our jobs for sure, definitely. And that is where the new hiring trend is going to happen. And that's where the internal teams are going to kind of react to the environment. And one more thing on the question, even also our friend Vivekananda asked earlier in terms of the co-working spaces. So one of the things that we were discussing recently, and some of the suggestions that have come in the survey that we have done also is that they were looking at not having office at one location. Okay. Now take out that office as it is, and wherever you are closer to one of the co-working place, probably your place. So that means a distributed workforce is going to actually work from multiple locations in Hyderabad. Just in case in Hyderabad, there are 10 offices rather than one office, which is holding 100 people. So I think that's also going to be some change, where they can't have fully, working from home kind of a situation. So that's another one, Amit. I think that's the kind of a change that's going to happen to your question. I'm sure a lot more changes that are going to happen in the future. So it's already 1 o'clock and it's so exciting that, 60 minutes just passed like that.
I know. I thought we were supposed to speak for half an hour. I didn't realize that.
So I didn't tell them. So I took the liberty to go to, 1 hour anyway. So we will definitely take any questions which are there online and we will answer it. But we will sign off here. Menon, thank you so much for, this opportunity. And I'm really excited that we were able to create some content which is useful, which will be reusable by people who are going to visit us again and again. Thank you so much
for the opportunity. All I've done is share my experience. I'm sure there's no right or wrong answers. And we learn as we go by.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We will answer the rest of the questions online. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Bye. And thank you. Thank you from for taking this time. Be there live. There are more than 30 people on an average that they were there constantly, which is a big thing. But I'm sure there are 3,000 more people are going to watch this post this session. Okay. See you then. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.